Sanskriti will now introduce today's speaker, Professor Rama Govindrajan, who will be talking on the dynamics of small particles in a flow.
Yeah, hello everyone. Professor Rama Govindrajan is a faculty and the academic dean at ICTS Bangalore. She did her bachelor's and master's from IIT Delhi and Drexel University in chemical engineering. Then she went on to work at the NAL Laboratories, National Aerospace Laboratories in Bangalore, during which she also got her PhD in aerospace engineering from IISc. So she finished her postdoctoral research at the Department of Aeronautics in Caltech, Pasadena, in 1994. And then she has held several faculty positions at JNCASR Bangalore and TIFR Hyderabad before she joined the fluid dynamics group at ICTS. So her group's work includes various topics on fluid mechanics, such as learning about flow instabilities, studying the mixing in Bay of Bengal, and cloud dynamics and modeling of the Indian monsoon. She won the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2007 and is also a fellow of several national and international academies. She actively advocates for a higher number of women in science and academia in general. She is also quite passionate about scientific outreach and talking to young students, courtesy of which she is here today. So if John doesn't have anything to say, I will invite her to begin her talk.
Thank you so much, Sanskriti, for this very nice introduction. Okay, so everybody is able to see my first slide, right? We already checked that. So now I want to tell you people that if you have a question, just start speaking. Don't wait to be asked. Just start speaking. Interrupt me anytime. So the topic for today is the dynamics of small particles in flow. And we're going to ask, is it interesting or boring? And at the end of the conversation, like, I hope you are going to vote for interesting. Okay, so now this is a slide to revise like what you studied in high school. So how many of you remember the Stokes solution that you studied? I don't know whether you studied it in 12th or for JEE or something. So can you raise your hands, those who remember it, or say yes? And say no if you don't remember it. So I see a few no's and many yeses. So let me just explain this thing. Let me just go over this recap to discuss what the Stokes solution is. So when you have a tiny, teeny sphere falling through a fluid, we usually make the approximation that it is in what is called Stokes flow. So what do we mean by Stokes flow? We basically have this Stokes equation, which looks like this. It equates the pressure gradient in a flow to the viscous forces. So it's a force balance where you've neglected inertia, you've neglected unsteadiness. This is a steady Stokes equation. And when you have a teeny tiny sphere falling through this, you can actually get something called an exact solution. You can analytically get the solution. And this is what you study in 12th standard. You typically do not study how that exact solution is derived from Stokes equation, but you get a formula for drag, which looks like this, which is 6 pi rho density of the fluid times kinematic viscosity of the fluid. And this product density into kinematic viscosity is what you call normally as the dynamic viscosity. And we're talking of a sphere of a small radius A. So the drag on this sphere is also proportionate to A, and it's proportionate to the velocity of the sphere V. So imagine I've got this, top of an ocean, and right at the top, I release a teeny sphere at zero velocity. Then I ask how the sphere is, let me say it's a little steel ball, so it's heavier than water, so it's going to fall. Or it could be a little dust particle falling in air. So then I ask what happens to this thing, like what is the velocity it has. So like in high school, you would have written this force balance. There's a downward force, which is the mass of the particle times gravity. And there's an upward force, which is an equivalent volume of fluid, the buoyancy term, which says that an equivalent volume of fluid is displaced, and that mass of that fluid gives an upward force, which is called the buoyancy force. And then there is this drag force, which is the fluid hates it when this particle is going through, so it's going to offer resistance. So this is the resistance force. So you can write a force balance, which is by Newton's laws, you can say that the mass into acceleration of the particle is equal to this force minus that force minus that force, because I've written it in downward, in the downward coordinate. And this is just a first order differential equation, which you can immediately solve to write down V is equal to V terminal times one minus something. So like basically you see that there is this time scale tau, and the time scale consists of the body's the particle's density, which should be rho p over here. Sorry for the typo. It's not rho b, it's rho p. Times the radius square of the particle divided by the density of the fluid times kinematic viscosity with some numerical factor. So like for a 10 micron particle in air, so usually dust particles and so many bigger aerosol particles, these are like typically 10 microns, tiny raindrops. For them, like the time scale is 2 milliseconds. So we can see from this formula that the velocity is going to reach terminal velocity exceed very, very fast, because this term will die down very, very fast. Like in a few milliseconds, this term will go to zero and the velocity will just reach the terminal velocity. So then the terminal velocity is given by this formula. It's like effectively G times tau times a constant. And if the fluid is much, much lighter than the body, like, you know, if the fluid is air and these are solid particles, we can neglect this. So it's just G tau. So the tau is the important parameter here, like, you know, the time scale at which it falls. So in high school, we say, okay, like in very short time, it's reached terminal velocity. So I'll assume that all spheres are falling at their terminal velocity. So we can calculate it from this. Now in 1851, G.G. Stokes had given this. Like normally the photo of Stokes you'll see will be that of an old man, but in 1851, I guess he looked more like this than like the really, really old white beard photo you might see in other places. So he gave this equation and he said, if the particle Reynolds number, this is called the Reynolds number, which is the radius times the velocity divided by the kinematic viscosity. He said, if this is much, 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 much less than one, then this kind of equation is valid. And if it is a sphere, I can actually write down the streamlines. So imagine that either the sphere is falling with velocity V, or the sphere is held constant and the flow is going upwards with velocity V. It's an equivalent problem. So each fluid particle will follow these streamlines as you see here. And given these streamlines, I can actually write down the solution of the Stokes equation and integrate across to get the full force given by the fluid, which is one of the very, very few, actual exact solutions in fluid mechanics. It's, with many, even this is an exact solution for an assumed equation. Remember that, because like we're effectively saying the Reynolds particle is zero, whereas all we can say in real life that it's very, very small, not zero. It's never going to be zero. Okay, so this is the high school revision. Any questions in this?
Ma'am, if the densities are equal, then what will happen? Like, will the particle...
Then the particle will be neutrally buoyant. It will neither go up or down. And if the particle is a bubble, so you know bubbles rise through water. Okay. So if it is lighter than the fluid, it will rise. If it's heavier than the fluid, it will fall. And if it's equal, it will go nowhere. It will stay just there. unless you've started it with an initial velocity, in which case it will take a tiny amount of time like this to come to a standstill. Okay, so shall we move on? Okay, so like I've given here some reasons to study droplet and particulate flows. So if you look around you, particulate and droplet, and I'm not going to differentiate between droplet and particulate in my talk, like solid particles and very, very tiny liquid particles are practically the same to study, because tiny, tiny liquid particles are going to remain spherical due to surface tension. And except for some flow within the particle, which changes the 6 pi factor by a little bit, nothing else changes. So we're going to talk about these two together. And you see that, you know, in oceans, there are these turbidity currents, you know, like when I'm just going in some random order. So like when you have, you know, water from the rivers flowing into the ocean, it could be very muddy water. And the entire mud thing, plume, can fall to the bottom of the ocean and form a huge current like this. This is marine snow, which involves like plankton and other carbonaceous substances falling through the ocean. And these are very important for carbon sequestration. So you know that we guys keep putting more and more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, and that's why the globe is warming and we have lots of other problems because of that. And these teeny tiny creatures, plankton, phytoplankton, zooplankton in the ocean, they have this big responsibility on their tiny shoulders to take some of that carbon, suck some of the, you know, extra carbon we're putting into the atmosphere and take it deep down into the ocean. When they die, they start sinking and other fishes eat them, and they die and start sinking and so on. So you're basically trapping carbon from the atmosphere and taking it deep down. So these guys are also slowly sedimenting through the ocean. Question, anybody? If you don't have a question, you could keep your mic off. Okay, so then there is volcanic ash, which you've seen, you know, eruptions from volcanoes and pollutant dispersal. So here is, you know, aerosol content on the globe on a certain day, which NOAA has given. Now, the higher color means more aerosol content. Aerosols are not all bad, okay? Like we need aerosol to create rain. So without aerosol, we wouldn't have rain. So that's very important. Here is aerosol coming out of a canister. And you know, like when people have asthma, like I have asthma, we take inhalers and things. So there's ocean spray, which releases tiny droplets into the atmosphere, which then evaporate. And then that becomes tiny salt particles in the atmosphere, which contribute to sea salt aerosol. So like they play a very important role. This ocean spray is very important in bringing us rain, not just to evaporate the water, but also to take aerosol into the atmosphere. And clouds are full of small droplets, aerosol particles. So we need to study droplet flows. COVID, of course, in recent times, you've heard so much about, you know, how droplets disperse, how droplets reach from person A to person B and so on. These are just a few examples. And just now we said, okay, like, you know, every tiny particle is going to keep sedimenting, and we know how to calculate the velocity. We write this very simple first order equation. We solve it. We get an exponential, very rapid arrival at terminal velocity. And I want you to remember this exponential word, because I'll be coming back to it. And then what is left? Like Stokes had given this in 1851. Since then, it's 170 years. We know the dynamics of each particle. So given the initial conditions, you know, like the number of particles, their, you know, sizes, their distribution, then like any crosswind which is carrying them, we can calculate the average spread of all this, you know, volcanic ash or whatever it is. And we can calculate how long it will take for, you know, a given bunch of pollutants or whatever they are to reach the ground. So everything is understood. So so I'm going to ask, am I serious or joking when I say I know everything? So you know the answer if you've read my abstract. The answer is joking. I put serious or joking because in the Bonvita quiz contest or something like that, when I was a kid, there used to be this serious or joking type quiz questions. I don't know whether any of you have seen those. So is the problem, clear so far? Is the motivation clear so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I've got one yes. I've got a few yeses. If anybody
I have a question.
Yeah, tell me.
Pratyusha, so is the T by tau aspect relevant in this question of serious or joking?
The question of T by tau will also be relevant. There's nothing in this serious or joking which is not relevant.
No.
So the tau time scale will be relevant.
Okay, so my point being, so in these situations that you defined, we do see where things don't die out very quickly. And hence, it's hard to calculate things. The velocity does not become...
That's one aspect which I'm going to explain in some detail. That's why I wanted you to remember this exponentially fast story. This exponentially fast story is quite incorrect. We will come back to that. But this time scale of the particle is an important, quantity. For 10 micron particle, it's 2 milliseconds because I know the kinematic viscosity of air is 10 to the power minus 5. I know that air's density is 1 kg per meter cube and almost any solid, water, whatever it is, will be 1000 kg per meter cube. So I can divide all this and 10 micron lagake, I can get 2 milliseconds. Now the interesting thing is when the particle sizes become bigger, you do not have any change in that particle material density, kinematic viscosity, and also because it's still air, more or less those numbers remain the same. But it scales as the square of the radius. So as your particle becomes bigger, then this time scale becomes bigger. More than that, the Reynolds number doesn't stay one, and it doesn't stay very small anymore. And so there's lots of problems which creep up when we when we go through this high school thing. So what are all the problems with this? That's what today's talk is about. And one of the things that Pratyush just now pointed out is that it may not be, this tau that's important, but some other tau may come in, or, it may not be exponential. That's what I'm going to tell you about. Okay.
Okay.
Carbon seeding is done, iodine is dispersed in the air to reduce pollution. So, is something like marine snow done to reduce, it's done artificially to reduce the carbon content in air?
There is, I've heard, such things being mentioned, there are very ambitious geoengineering projects where they want to change the entire way the world works, interfere with everything on a big scale, and that's just to help us continue doing the bad things we do, drive lots of cars, use lots of plastic. We want to continue living this very wasteful lifestyle, and we want to do big things to the world to change. So one thing we can do is make so many more phytoplankton, you make so much more life in the ocean that they can suck more and more carbon. And then you can, accelerate this marine snow stuff by a lot. And as you can see from my previous, the last few sentences, I'm not an advocate of that. I'm totally against, large scale interference with life forms, large scale interference with, these balances, because the Earth is a very, very, very complicated nonlinear dynamical system, and you meddle with one thing, it'll change a million other things that you have no other holdover. So you think you're going to improve one thing, but you may make 100 things much worse because of such interference. Does that answer your question, Sanskriti?
Yes.
Okay. So I've written here a few of the things which change the answer. Which make the simple-minded high school calculation not correct. So these are a few of the things, and I'm going to go through them one by one. So here I've given a photo of a snow avalanche, and here I've given a photo of a dust storm. Now you can see that both of these are particulate matter. Now, in the snow avalanche, there's one interesting thing, which is why I brought this. You know, it comes down like a huge, you know, turbulent, you know, a very big turbulent hurricane type thing, like, which, I mean, it's massive and it's got very, very high speed flows. So how does this happen? It's not just teeny tiny particles, you know, falling gently. So like, what is the difference? So that thing I'm showing here. So here are, you know, some falling particles of snow, which I've drawn in purple color. And, you know, I told you that each of them has you know, if they're even tiny, teeny tiny, they disturb the flow around them. So there is, you know, some streamlines, the hydrodynamics in their neighborhood gets modified. And when the hydrodynamics gets modified, the air around them is moving around. So like, and because of many of them, you know, doing things to the air is going through very complicated paths. And first of all, the particle Reynolds number need not be small, but we'll come back later. But right now we're talking about very tiny particle Reynolds numbers. But in spite of that, the air Reynolds number can become very large. So anytime you have a large scale flow, you have turbulence. We'll come to that in a minute. And this air flow can be so strong that it can erode, you know, as this avalanche keeps coming down, it can erode, you know, snow particles, which are quiet up to then. And it can collect, you know, it can make the whole hillside bare as it goes around. And so the air is basically lifting up or, you know, fluidizing these particles, which were initially in the bed and they were staying quiet. So now, like, much more snow is coming down as you progress, and that's because of the turbulent collection of these particles. So, you know, things can become bigger and bigger without you realizing it. So it's not enough if you just say these particles fall to the ground. You're actually confronted with a much bigger physical phenomenon, much more complicated physical phenomenon than just a few particles or many particles sedimenting. So because I use the word turbulence, I want to spend a couple of minutes on it. How many of you have studied anything about turbulence? Like, have you heard that there is laminar flow and turbulent flow, and after a certain Reynolds number, flow becomes turbulent? Yes, no? I'll wait for your answers on this. Let me see some more answers. Many people are not answering. Okay, so there are a few no's and a lot of yeses. So what I'm going to say here is the following. Basically, I'll just assume that, you know, I'll say a little bit for the no people. So like, basically any flow that's very, very large scale, and I put any within quotes because I don't want to go into that, like there can be exceptions. Almost any flow which is very large scale is turbulent. And turbulence is very difficult to understand because turbulence, so somebody is saying here, only heard about the limits of stream flow on the basis of Reynolds number. Okay, yeah, the limits of laminar flow. So beyond a certain Reynolds number, you get turbulence. So any large scale flow effectively is turbulent. And turbulence is a very, very counterintuitive thing because, you know, normally, like we talked about, you know, a force acting on a body and then Newton's laws on it. Normally, if you think that flow is something which happens from, let's say, high pressure region to low pressure region. So if the pressure is high here, the pressure is low here, you expect a uniform flow to go from the high pressure to the low pressure as a response to forcing. So you say that the net forcing is in a given direction, but and the flow also should be in that direction. Instead of which, like, you know, the flow goes in all kinds of directions, like each individual fluid particle, fluid blob is going in random directions. There's lots of vorticity. So all of these four pictures you see are, all the red things are actually, you know, regions of the flow where the flow is rotating immensely hard. The rotationality or the curl of the velocity vector is extremely high. So almost from nowhere in this small portion of a cloud, it could be any other turbulent flow. It could be inside your washing machine. It could be any of those things. you see like large amounts of rotationality, you see large amounts of what is called vorticity. And this vorticity is organized into tubes, into plates, things which slide past each other. And there's like, you know, they're going in every direction. So every fluid parcel is forcing every other fluid parcel in the most complicated ways. And this is like chaos to an intense degree. So this is a basic thing of what turbulence is. It's counterintuitive, like instead of following just the force, you get this. So now, yes.
You had mentioned that all large scale systems are turbulent, right?
Yes.
So what do you mean? What do you mean by large scale here? And why is that? Why are they always turbulent?
So the Reynolds number is defined by some velocity scale, some length scale, divided by the kinematic viscosity. Okay. So if the typical length scale becomes larger and larger and larger, the Reynolds becomes larger and larger and larger. And in almost anything on Earth, you will find Reynolds of several million.
So
because, you know, the small...
Yes? This length is like the physical length of the system that we're looking at.
Yes, yes. Right. The length would be the length of this... I just don't understand this thing. The length would be the length scale of this cloud, for example. The entire cloud.
So like if we look at like rivers or so, are you saying that they will always be turbulent?
Like yeah, rivers will typically always be turbulent, river flows, unless, you know, for some reason it's coming to a standstill, which will never happen. Typically, rivers are going to be turbulent. The flow through any pipe, like when, you know, when you switch on your motor and you pump up water to your overhead tank, that's going to be turbulent. Any exhaust which is given out from a running vehicle is going to be turbulent. So like if you could see turbulence, if you could see vorticity, you will see it everywhere. If you could color this in, you know, in the room around me, right? Like right now I have my fan switched on. If I could color my room on vorticity, I'd see it everywhere. Is this, you want to ask anything
yes,
more?
Clear.
What?
No, that's clear.
Okay.
It's clear, it's clear.
Okay, stop me anytime. Okay, so everything almost around us is turbulent. And if we want to understand particulate flows, so for example, the snow avalanche, you see that from nowhere this large scale flow comes in. Just the particles pushing around the flow, if there's many, 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 many particles, it can create turbulence on its own. In dust storms, it's a little more complicated because there's already wind in the atmosphere, whereas snow avalanches can happen in perfectly still air. So the way people do research in snow avalanches is actually they, you know, take some dynamite in an aircraft and they throw the dynamite from a low-flying aircraft. And then that creates a small explosion which starts some snow particles moving. And then they see how it amplifies and amplifies and amplifies by collecting more and more particles. Of course,
so ma'am, when they come down, do the number of particles in the avalanche increase?
They keep increasing because they're eroding the bed as they go down. So like you see this portion in the mountain?
Yes.
It's covered by snow, right? So the entire mountain is covered by snow, right?
Yes.
And the avalanche is starting in one small place somewhere up there. It could be a tiny avalanche. But that thing keeps gathering more and more and more snow as it goes down. It clears these. I've drawn a bed here and it's eroding the bed. It's carrying the bed with it. So it becomes bigger and bigger in size.
So when the net velocity also increases as they come down?
Net velocity increases and decreases. There's lots of things happening. And So basically, like a whole bunch of potential energy is getting converted to kinetic energy. So like initially, when the potential energy is getting converted to kinetic energy, you'll see a rapid increase in velocity. But then when you're eroding things which were standing still, these people will share their kinetic energy. So then net velocity may go down, but the mass flux will increase. And then as they go further down, there's more potential energy getting converted to kinetic energy so they can accelerate. Then there's also drag from the wall, from the bottom, which is going to slow them down. So there'll be, you know, speeding up and slowing down of different things.
Okay.
Okay. So I put that list of things, right? And in this slide, I discussed turbulence first, things which are going to make it different from the high school thing. So when it's turbulent, you have to solve this thing called the Navier-Stokes equations. How many of you have seen this equation? Hands. If you don't show your hand, I'll assume you've never seen it. Okay, so the Navier-Stokes equation is for the fluid velocity at any given point and the pressure gradient at that point. And it's going to depend on spatial gradients and temporal gradients. It is basically Newton's laws written for many blobs of fluid sitting together. So it's a very, very complicated equation to solve. There's, you know, the Clay Millennium Prize. There's questions on the Navier-Stokes. Navier-Stokes is very, very, very important. It's all over the place. And I mean, anything which is not solid for which you want to apply Newton's laws, there's often, you know, a limit in which you can use Navier-Stokes. So this flow Reynolds number, I said, is very big in Earth systems. For example, around 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9 for clouds, even maybe 10 to the 7. There's another thing which comes from mass balance. So this is momentum balance, effectively Newton's law. This is mass balance, which for an incompressible fluid can be written as del dot u is zero. And you know, when you throw away this term, the u dot grad u term, which is the inertial term, nonlinear term, you get a linear equation, and that is called the unsteady Stokes equation. And then we threw away this term to get the steady Stokes equation earlier. And we said this thing can be solved to get the drag in faster sphere, right? This is what we'd done. Now, what I'm trying to tell you is that unsteadiness is very important. Even in a small particle where, let me pretend that I can throw away this term, I have to remember that it's unsteady. That means the velocity is changing as a function of time. It can accelerate, decelerate. So that thing can change the answer a lot. So unsteadiness completely changes the answer, and everything we learned about sedimenting flow becomes different now. So one thing is that, like, you know, it's not just these equations, but you need the equations to satisfy the boundary conditions. And in this talk, I've said V is the velocity of any particle and U is the velocity of the air around it. So like whenever R is equal to A, namely, if you have a spherical particle of radius A and I've kept the origin at the particle, whenever it's at the particle surface, the two velocities should match. So this kind of boundary conditions also, it should satisfy at every particle. So already you're beginning to see that it's a very complicated problem, because I have many, 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 many particles and I have many, many boundary conditions to satisfy, and these equations should satisfy so many boundary conditions everywhere. And already you can see that it's reaching the level of impossible, although the equation is linear. You haven't even gone to non-linear. So in any math physics course, you would have studied that non-linearity is an extremely complicated thing. But here you're so-called living with linear equations, and already it's becoming unmanageably complicated to get any averages, any understanding, anything. So we need to start simplifying it. To solve the unsteady Stokes equation is like a computationally crazy exercise. So are you all with me till now? Like, am I going too fast? You have any questions, anything?
And this U that we are solving for is the velocity of the fluid, right? Which is around, yes, around the sphere.
This is the velocity of fluid everywhere in the flow, which is a function of x, y, z and time. It's a function of three spatial coordinates and time. So u is a quantity which is defined in space and time.
So we still haven't come to a situation where a ball is flowing through the fluid, right? In this equation.
In this thing, like, suppose...
So like when we...
Yeah.
Like when we first started out, you showed us the Stokes equation.
Yes.
So in that, how do we change this particular equation to get the Stokes equation? Like,
so in this equation, if I throw away this term, I get the Stokes equation. So let me go up. I wrote the Stokes equation here, right?
Yes, yes.
Now I've just added a time derivative to that.
Okay, yes.
Okay, so I've got the unsteady Stokes equation. So I've got this one. Is that clear? Yes, Sunil. Hello?
No, that was me. That was Jay.
That was Jay. Okay. Hi, yeah, Jay. Yeah. Tell me.
No, so I had a different question. I mean, you can complete your... Sorry.
Okay, no, I'm done. You can tell me your question.
So I was just wondering, I mean, what do you consider as a fluid over here? Like when we are talking about fluid, like sand, can you consider sand as a fluid?
Okay, so in my language, yes, like granular materials are kind of fluids. I'm not going there today. In my language, like anything like air or water, anything which is not a solid is a fluid. And I'm considering a fluid with lots of small particles in it. And all those particles, the sand, snow, even raindrops, everything I'm going to consider as solids.
Okay. And so, would all of these equations apply if the solid particles in the liquid that you are considering are of comparable size with the particles in the liquid?
No, they won't apply. If you have like, you know, so some things, let's say there's water, I've got water, right? And then I put an object which is the size of a water molecule, which is solid. And you're asking whether these equations will be the same. That's what you're asking, right?
Yes, yes.
That those equations will be completely different. When we say tiny particles, we mean they're way, way bigger than molecular size. If I have molecular size particles, I cannot write the Navier-Stokes. I will get, you know, thermal fluctuations. I will get, you know, like some water molecules pushing it from this side, pushing it from that side. And I'll get Brownian motion, which is a result of these thermal fluctuations. I'll get lots more complications. In this thing, I've made what is called the continuum approximation, where I've said I've got a blob of fluid. And this blob of fluid moves together with an average velocity u. Each molecule there will be going with square root of kt or something. But on an average, they're moving together with a particular velocity.
So over here in like comparatively larger molecules, you said that all those thermal, we're kind of neglecting the thermal fluctuations or individual molecular interactions with the liquid.
Yes, we are neglecting that. So actually, like, you know, if I have very, very small aerosol or dust particles, which are less than a micron, then this equation is not correct. Everything I'm saying is not correct because they will be subjected to random walk, Brownian motion, which I've not included here. I would have to include something there for smaller particles. So this equation is more or less okay for, you know, particles which are bigger than 10 micron or bigger than a micron, and small enough to make the particle Reynolds number close to zero. Whereas in the cloud itself, big raindrops don't satisfy that. The particle Reynolds number may not be zero. So yeah, it is like, you know, for micron sized particles in air or, you know, slightly bigger particles in water, like which are, I mean, slightly different sized particles of plankton and so on in water. But this thing is limited. This whole study is limited to particles of a narrow range of sizes. But those things can also be studied if you add, you know, the right effects.
Ma'am, when you said that flow Reynolds number is 10 power 8 for clouds, so what do you mean when you said grad of u is equal to 0? What does it mean physically as far as the cloud is concerned?
Del dot u equal to 0. That's what you're asking?
Yes.
Okay, grad of u is not 0. Del dot u is 0. Hey, are you hearing disturbance?
Vatsal, please mute when you're not.
Yeah, maybe if you mute and then open your mic when you want to talk. Okay, so del dot u is zero. That means divergence of u is zero. So this means that, like, basically whatever u is coming into a volume, the same, whatever mass flux, volume flux is coming into a given volume, the same amount of fluid is leaving. So we are saying fluid is not accumulating, like it's incompressible fluid. So like if I take a particular volume and I say that 1 gram of one cc of water has come in from outside in 1 second here, some other 1 cc has to leave from my volume. That's all that this means. This is just a mass conservation. It's not gradu. Is this clear? So divergence tells you how much is coming in or how much is going out from all the walls together, right? It's a net flux.
Yes, yes.
So this just says that my net flux is zero because it's incompressible fluid. Even air can be considered incompressible in most of our situations. But there are many situations in which you cannot say this for air, and that we are not going into now.
Ma'am? Mm? So for Jay's question, you had mentioned Brownian motion. And so in the equation below, I see that if you remove the grad P wala term, then you get the diffusion equation. So
yes.
So how do you visualize that?
See this thing, like the diffusion term here is coming from, you know, molecular diffusivity. This thing is actually coming from molecular diffusivity. So already the fact that the fluid, the air or water is in Brownian motion, I've accounted for it here. Okay. Whereas the fact that the particles could be in Brownian motion, I have not accounted for that. I've said the particles are too big to do Brownian motion of their own. So like I just solve some equation for V. Knowing the U, I'll solve for V and I'll apply this boundary condition. The particle itself is not doing Brownian motion. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Okay.
So then that's the unsteady Stokes equation. And there is this, for very, very tiny spherical particles, there's this brilliant equation called the Maxey-Rayleigh equation, which says, okay, like, you know, don't panic. You don't have to solve unsteady Stokes equation for each particle. And it's a huge simplification. It says, so long as the particle is a sphere, a small sphere in unsteady Stokes flow, it's given by this equation. So its dynamics is given by this equation. So like it's exactly given by this equation. So that is what Maxey-Rayleigh tells you for a spherical particle of small size. And given that this my size is small, I can throw away these terms. I don't want to go into each of those terms. But let's look at what you studied in high school. In high school, your fluid was not moving. So your fluid didn't have inertia. You didn't have that term. You had this term, the gravity term, you know, weight minus buoyancy. So you had this Newton's law, which we wrote down in the first slide, which was rho p times v is rho p minus rho f. That means weight minus buoyancy times gravity. And we had the Stokes drag term. And now in the Stokes drag term, I'm saying that the drag is proportional to the relative velocity between particle and fluid next to it. So like Maxey and Rayleigh assumed that the particles are so small that the fluid flow is not affected by the particles. And this was a gross simplification. So the fluid can have a different velocity in the exact same place that the particle is going through. The particle is so tiny that the fluid doesn't care. Like imagine ocean, you're considering the waves velocity or something. It doesn't care that there's a small germ or a plankton there. So it will have its own velocity. And so like you're not satisfying the boundary conditions truly at that place, but this is a small price you pay. And so like you get these two terms, which we saw before. And then there's one more term which we won't go into, but it's like the fact that whenever a body is moving through fluid, you also push along some fluid. So the work done is not only to push the body, but also to push along some of the fluid. So you have an added mass. And then you have this very complicated term called the Bassett history term. So I was planning to talk a little bit about this, but I want your feedback. Like if people are lost already, it's very good to drop Bassett history from this discussion altogether. And instead of that, discuss, you know, anything, like any questions you have on this story so far.
And this added mass term in this equation, is it like the particle like carrying some amount of fluid along with it while it's moving? Is that it?
Exactly, exactly. Okay. So like suppose, can you see my hand? I don't know whether that's visible. Can you see my hand?
Yes, yes.
So like suppose I'm a disc and I'm going like this. I'll push a large amount of fluid on along with me, right? So yes. I have to do more work than if I'm going like this. When I'll push less fluid. You get my point?
Yes, yes.
So like this thing is called the added mass. And for a sphere, like whichever way it moves, it will carry the same amount of fluid. And there's calculations you can do to show that it's half the volume of the particle, that amount of fluid it will carry with it in added mass. And Varun Joshi is asking, how are these equations affected by temperature? Varun, these equations are affected a lot by temperature. I've assumed isothermal here, but they're affected a lot by temperature. So like, for example, the fluid density can change due to temperature. The fluid viscosity can change due to temperature. And there can be other effects, like if it is a droplet, it can evaporate, condense, depending on the temperature. And so the radius can grow or shrink. This A can grow or shrink. Many, many things can happen due to temperature. And Varun, hereafter, if you have a question, just ask it because I'm not paying much attention to the chat box.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
How was this equation derived?
How, it's a very complicated derivation from the Stokes, from the this unsteady Stokes equation. It's effectively the unsteady Stokes equation for one small sphere. And it's derived by, you know, knowing the streamlines, and there's like very clever tricks they employed, knowing the Stokes drag and knowing everything for the steady case. They extended it to the unsteady case by employing a lot of tricks. It's an elaborate derivation. But you can look up Maxie Riley's paper of 1983. And you'll get it over there. So just tell me, like in all frankness, like who is lost? Like even if one or two people are lost, we can spend time on them. So can you raise your hand if you're lost? Okay. Can you tell me where I lost you? Abhay, Varun. Tell me where I lost you.
After the Navier-Stokes.
After the Navier-Stokes equation. So shall we go back there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so we are here. What do you want to ask here? See, the Navier-Stokes equation is a very, very complicated equation to derive for me here, but just take it from me right now that it's Newton's laws for a fluid. And this P is pressure. And it's written in non-dimensional form. So is this okay, till now?
The thing is quite unfamiliar. We are unfamiliar with those, you know, non-dimensional notations.
Oh, okay, you're unfamiliar. Okay, let me tell you a little bit more about this then. Okay, so what you do is that you take a blob of fluid and you ask what are the forces acting on it. And in for any given, in the simplest case, there'll be a pressure acting on it, pressure forces acting on a blob of fluid, and there'll be viscous forces acting on a blob of fluid. Okay, the viscous forces come from this molecular diffusivity that somebody asked me about a little bit more earlier. And this whole left-hand side is actually what is called a Lagrangian derivative. So like you have dou u by dou t plus u dot grad u, that's the same as writing du by dt. So it's the Lagrangian. So if I live with a blob if I go with, and I move with the fluid block. So like normally, suppose I'm asking what is the force on a tennis ball, then I will keep moving with the tennis ball, right? Like I'll write down mass into acceleration of tennis ball is equal to sum of forces. Then I move the tennis ball. I go to the new place where the tennis ball is and I'll ask mass into acceleration of this portion of the space. What is that? And net sum of forces. And then I'll move it according to the acceleration and the velocity. This is how I'll follow a tennis ball, right? Same way I'm following every blob of fluid. Every blob of fluid I'm following, and that derivative, the acceleration du by dt of a moving blob of fluid is given in terms of what is called the Eulerian derivative here, which is du by dou t plus u dot grad u. So this du by dou t is the acceleration not of a given blob of fluid, but of the fluid. So imagine that I'm sitting in a box and fluid is flowing past it. So I'm sitting in this box and at time t, I'm asking what's the velocity. At time t plus delta t, I'm asking what's the velocity. And I'm taking the derivative to get you the Eulerian derivative dou u by dou t. That is not the acceleration of a parcel of fluid. Are you able to get the difference?
Mom, I think we don't know what the Eulerian derivative means.
I'm just defining it for you.
The Eulerian
derivative is this quantity dou u by dou t, okay? The Lagrangian derivative is the sum of this and this.
So okay. why is dou u by dou t not the acceleration?
Dou u by dou t is the acceleration if I'm stuck to one place. So imagine that, you know, there's a whole bunch of tennis balls going, okay? So imagine in tennis balls, it's easier to imagine that than fluid. So in a tennis ball, like, you know, suppose I have, you know, this place, I'm sitting at this dabba, and then like one ball is going at velocity u1 and the next ball is going at velocity u2. So the acceleration I'm noticing in a given place is u1 minus u2 by delta t, correct?
Okay.
Yes. That is not the acceleration of either tennis ball 1 or tennis ball 2.
Okay.
Tennis ball 1 ka acceleration, if I want, I can't be stuck to one place. I must move with the tennis ball. And I have to keep asking how it's accelerating. Got that?
So what you actually subtracted were the two velocities of the two tennis balls. U1
exactly, exactly. That's just, it's not an acceleration of any of the tennis balls.
Hmm.
It's just the acceleration I'm perceiving when I'm sitting in place A.
So basically this, the difference between both is just the frame of reference.
Exactly, exactly. The Lagrangian derivative is in a moving frame of reference which moves with the flow velocity u, and that is this entire quantity. The Eulerian acceleration is this quantity where I'm stuck to place A and I'm just, you know, checking A ka velocity, B ka velocity, and I'm taking time derivatives of those. So the difference is a frame of reference. Is this clear to everybody?
What is the Reynolds number and how does it come into play in this equation?
Okay. That's a good question. So like basically, like I would have, if I'm writing Newton's laws, I should actually write mass into acceleration, right? I'll write mass into acceleration equal to some pressure force and some viscous force, which will be viscosity times something. And then I'll divide throughout by the mass, and I'm going to write this for every unit volume. When I do that, I divide throughout by that, and then I non-dimensionalize everything. That means I divide throughout by a velocity scale and a time scale, multiply by a time scale and divide by a velocity scale, in order to get everything in dimensionless numbers. And then I'll get like this kind of Reynolds number on the right-hand side. So basically it's 1 over Reynolds number on the right-hand side. So there's viscosity in the numerator and some velocity scale and length scale in the denominator. So by non-dimensionalizing this equation, I get this. The reason I non-dimensionalize is the following. See, I could have a flow in a washing machine, which has size, the washing machine has a size of 1 meter. And so my L is 1 meter and my velocity is, you know, 10 meters per second or something like that. Whereas in a cloud, my length could be 1 kilometer. And let me just imagine that my velocity is 1 millimeter per second. Then the cloud Reynolds number in that imaginary situation is the same as the washing machine Reynolds number. So if I've solved, you know, for a small region of my washing machine, I don't have to solve for my cloud. I'll get the same kind of average behavior. So given a Reynolds number and given boundary conditions, I get an average behavior. I don't have to solve for honey separate, air separate, water separate. I don't have to solve for different kinds of, you know, situations. So there's only one parameter rather than length separate, velocity separate, viscosity separate, and so on. So another way to put it is, like, suppose I take a fluid of viscosity 1 and it's flowing with a velocity of 1. The answer will be the same as another fluid of the same length who has a viscosity of 2 and is flowing with velocity of 2. So, like, non-dimensionalizing buys me this thing that the number of parameters, instead of, you know, length, velocity, viscosity, everything acting separately, actually act together only as this, you know, product divide. I mean, this kind of combination. Only this combination matters, and each one individually does not matter. So that's why, like, fluid mechanicians, the minute they see a problem, they will non-dimensionalize it. And mind this thing that geometry matters a lot. So when I say it will have the same thing given the Reynolds number, I'm assuming that the boundary conditions are the same. Remember that in a washing machine, the boundary conditions are, you know, walls on all sides, and in a cloud, it's not. So I won't get the same answer in the big scale for washing machine and cloud. But if I have two washing machines, one half the size, running with twice the velocity, I'll get the same answer. Does this help? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions on this? I don't need to go to the rest of the talk at all.
Ma'am, how is turbulence different from unsteadiness?
Okay. So, like, you can have a simple unsteadiness. For example, like, I could have, you know, let's say I put a big blob of salt water inside fresh water. Then this salt water will, if it is, you know, remaining in its shape and going down, you know, faster and faster, that I would call as unsteadiness. Whereas if it is doing very complicated chaotic motion, if it is mixing with the rest of the fluid and it is, you know, giving vorticity and overturning, and the picture you get is like this. If you get this kind of picture, then, like, that is called turbulence. And this has very characteristic behavior. Like, you know, on an average, there's many quantities you can pull out for this, which will be the same, given a Reynolds number and geometry. I can pull out many such quantities. Whereas if I'd taken a very teeny tiny amount of salt water and put it in fresh water, it would go down, but it will go down so slowly that it will be unsteady but not turbulent. So turbulence happens when you have really large scale, and always and always you'll get, you know, characteristic behavior like this. So turbulence is extremely chaotic. It's extremely vortical. That means there's lots of vorticity. The vorticity in each length scale is characteristically different. The vorticity, the energy, kinetic energy keeps getting transferred from big scales to small scales on an average in 3D turbulence. And then it gets dissipated in viscosity. So there's a huge number of features which distinguish turbulence from laminar flow or just unsteady laminar flow.
But can we say that the turbulence is a kind or specific kind of unsteadiness only?
Yes, turbulence is unsteady.
And
turbulence is unsteady, but turbulence need not be unsteady on an average. It could be steady on an average.
So it is not completely like a random motion.
It is random motion, but it's random motion which obeys Newton's laws for a fluid.
Okay.
And that makes it very interesting compared to the usual random motion.
And what force drives this vorticity? I mean, is it pressure difference?
So you have to force it in some way, otherwise turbulence will die down in no time. So like, you know, if I take a spoon and I shake it in my teacup and then I leave it, after some time it comes to a standstill, right? So like I have to give, you know, momentum through my spoon, or in my washing machine, I have to rotate a drum. On the earth, like from earth's rotation, these things can collect some energy. They also collect energy from convection, like in clouds. When things go from down to up, like lighter air rises, then potential energy gets converted to kinetic energy. And you can have chemical energy getting converted to kinetic energy. For example, when you have phase change. So suppose you have a whole lot of condensation happening, then the latent heat given out due to the condensation can change the potential energy a lot, and that can go into kinetic energy. So you have to keep on feeding energy. And like in my washing machine, if I suppose washing machine or mixie, if I keep it switched on all the time, like let's say I have a washing machine which can be switched on 24/7, then I've got steady turbulence. So on an average, I don't see any time variation. If I take the average of all this behavior at one instant, it's the same as if I come back tomorrow and take. So on an average, nothing is changing, but each vortex is getting created. It dies, it moves other vortices around it. It, you know, entrains, it does a lot of things. Like each portion of the fluid is doing lots of unsteady behavior, but on an average, it's steady. Am I conveying this point to you all? Yes or no?
Yes.
Feel happy to say no. Yes, Abhay.
Is there are so many disturbances and these many kinds of forces, and how does that gross generalization to that formula that we read in high school of drag comes and becomes something that is somewhat close?
Can you repeat your question?
You're saying that there are so many disturbances. I mean, these many factors affecting the equation for the flow of any particle. I mean, flow of the fluid. Then how the gross generalization comes us very close to the real answer that we read in the class 12, right?
Okay, so there's two aspects to that question. One is that the simple sedimenting velocity will not be correct for in general. It will not be correct. But the Maxey-Rayleigh will be correct, which is again a huge simplification of this whole thing. And the reason that that works is that the particle size A is much, much, much smaller than all these vortex sizes. So these vortices have a lot of sizes, but in, let's say, cloud turbulence, beyond 1 millimeter, smaller than 1 millimeter, there'll be no vortex. So the smallest vortex will be about a millimeter in dia. And this particle is 10 microns. So when the particle is sitting in the vortex, it sees only one typical velocity. It doesn't see too many other velocities. So like I can write V minus U because there is a big flow U and small particle which has a velocity V.
So it only sees that vortex, only that vortex.
It will see one tiny, teeny portion of a vortex where, so imagine that the vortex is in solid body rotation. At any given rate, they're actually not in perfect solid body rotation, but that's not important. So at a given place, there'll be one characteristic rotational velocity, right? And the particle is way, way, way smaller than that. So it sees only one velocity. So the left of the particle and the right of the particle are moving with almost the same velocity. Is this okay?
Yes.
More questions?
There are some questions in the
chat. On the chat, can somebody read it out?
Yes, ma'am, I'll read it out. So there's one question. Does the change from laminar flow to turbulent flow happen steadily or abruptly? Also, does the complete system become turbulent at once?
Okay, that's a very nice question. It so depends on the flow. So there are some flows which, you know, can be laminar below a certain Reynolds number and perfectly turbulent above a certain Reynolds number. That's not very typical. Typically, like, you know, a flow will be laminar below, let's say, a Reynolds number of 1,500, turbulent above 5,000, and between 1,500 and 5,000, I'm just making up numbers. It depends on the geometry and many things. You can have partly laminar and partly turbulent. So you can have a turbulent intermittency. So this kind of thing can happen. So as you crank up the Reynolds number, the transition from laminar to turbulent is very gradual. And if I'm sitting in the region which is neither laminar nor turbulent, I can see puffs of turbulence as well as quiet. So puffs and quiet. So I can witness, you know, turbulent, laminar, you know, going past me in quick succession. And typically the boundary between the turbulent and laminar patches of fluid will be sharp. So for some time I'll see perfect laminar, then I'll see very turbulent, then laminar and so on. So it depends so much on the flow. And for example, like, you know, when a puff of smoke comes out from a vehicle, that thing goes turbulent at a Reynolds number of 100 or something. So it depends on the geometry. Whereas in a pipe, it's like 2000. There are situations where you can push, you can get laminar flow at 1 lakh. So like the number at which it goes is also not universal. Samvit, does it answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Okay, great. So I see a question from Abhijit Sinha. What if size of the particles be of order, say 30 centimeters or more? Say, for example, tumbleweeds kind of ellipsoid in shape when they flow over open land due to wind cluster. Cluster, disperse, merge, break. Can we do the same analysis there? No, there you will have to solve the complete Navier-Stokes equations. You cannot solve the Maxey-Rayleigh equations. Because anything which is, you know, 30 centimeters is, you know, like you cannot get away with ascribing one fluid velocity to it. You have to satisfy the boundary conditions perfectly. Tumbleweed is a nightmare, by the way, because it is not a perfect ellipsoid. It is very porous, so wind can go through it also. So like, I can actually give you a bet that to solve for a full tumbleweed, the full Navier-Stokes on a tumbleweed and satisfy the boundary conditions everywhere, you're going to need like some of the world's best computers. You're going to need like 1 lakh cores connected in parallel or something to solve for its dynamics. So like even a simple thing like one blob moving, in order to solve it from first principles, solve the Newton's equations from first principles for this object is going to take you like, you know, 1 month on a supercomputer or something.
Somebody could explain what a tumbleweed is?
Okay. So tumbleweed is like, you know, a bunch of grasses. It's normally seen in open prairie land and typically in the US, like a lot of people have given movies of them, like, you know, when you're driving on a highway and you've got open land on both sides of you, it can happen in any country, but so you see like, you know, all these portions of grasses and weeds, they've joined together and clumped into blobs, and these blobs then start rolling over the ground. And so like, you know, there's turbulence in the air and that pushes these tumbleweeds, they keep tumbling as they go. So like even in at home and all, if people have long hair which is dropped on the ground, you can see like some kind of tumbleweed forming with hair, and you know, big blob of hair moves around. It's slightly more disgusting than tumbleweed, but the idea is the same.
So like we can still apply these ideas from fluid mechanics to model these systems, like even though they're not fluids in the sense.
Well, they are. It is fluid-solid interaction. So you have to solve for a solid which is being moved by the fluid, and the fluid is being moved by the solid. So they're moving each other. So it's a fluid solid interaction problem where you have to make sure that you're solving for the entire flow of the fluid, and you're satisfying the boundary conditions of the solid, and then you're seeing what force is applied by the solid to the fluid and by the fluid to the solid. And you have to account for all these forces, and effectively you're doing Newton's laws very, very carefully. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
More questions?
Ma'am, can you please explain the kinematic viscosity part?
Okay. Kinematic viscosity is just a quantity which fluid mechanicians use. Like we just, it has advantages which I won't go into now, but it's basically nothing but the normal viscosity divided by the fluid density. It's viscosity divided by fluid density. That's kinematic viscosity. It is convenient because it's like other diffusivities. It's got units of meter square per second, stuff like that. And so you can make other non-dimensional numbers with it, comparing it to other diffusivities. So for operational reasons, it's used rather than the dynamic viscosity.
Ma'am, I noticed that when it comes to the equation, there were many equations that were related to each other than. So the Navier-Stokes, the Stokes equation, the unsteady Stokes equation, the Navier-Stokes equation. And then I think Chandrasekhar also mentioned this diffusion equation at some point, how one equation can simply be. So I have a feeling that there is a lot of physical ideas that we can probably take from understanding these equations. What do you think about that?
Yeah. So, what is your question? Your question is, how do I go from here to here?
So, I don't know. Yeah, if that is something that can be understood in an intuitive manner.
Yeah, that's easy. So, you've got Navier-Stokes, right? Mm-hmm. Now, this is effectively, if I can treat fluid as a continuum, I can neglect, the Brownian motion of average. I mean, the Brownian motion, except in the diffusive effects. There's no particle which is Brownianly moving and so on. Then this equation is a very good equation. It's pretty exact. It's if I can solve it exactly, I know everything about turbulence. I know everything about it. And right now I'm talking about a fluid in which there are no solids. So that would be my Navier-Stokes equation. It's a perfect force balance. And then for an incompressible fluid. So then given this thing, how can I, and I know that no computer on earth can solve this. Nobody can solve for an entire cloud, accounting for all the length and time scales. No computer on earth can solve this. And because of that, I'm forced to do simplifications of different kinds. On top of it, I'm now confronted with a particulate flow where there are many, many particles with this kind of, boundary conditions of forcing between fluid and solid that's going on. So then I have to find, some simplifying ways where I may not get the exact answer, but I'll get something like a reasonable answer. And that's when we start simplifying these like crazy. And so when I do that, one thing I can do is I can solve for the flow around every particle with this particle Reynolds number, and just the neighborhood of every particle, I can solve the unsteady Stokes. Now, in the particle neighborhood, in that tiny neighborhood of the particle, the relevant Reynolds number is based not on the big length scale, but this tiny fluid knows only what the particle is doing. So the relevant length scale is the particle size. And so I can throw away this term, which is order Reynolds bigger than this term. So it's order Reynolds smaller than this term. So out of these four terms, I've thrown away this one and I get this. And that's how I've, in the neighborhood of the particle, I've reduced it to the unsteady Stokes equation. And then I make a whole bunch of approximations on this for a given teeny tiny sphere. Things like this, saying that the fluid doesn't get affected by the solid, but the solid is affected. I mean, the solid does, the fluid is going undisturbed. when I do, you know, assumptions like that, and I don't exactly satisfy this, I can write down the Maxey-Riley equation. I can write down this Maxey-Riley equation, which looks more complicated, but it's actually a much, much, much more simplified version of this, because now I'm not solving for the fluid. I'm just solving for each particle velocity, knowing the local fluid. So then, like, I can solve for the fluid independently and pretend that the fluid is not affected by these tiny solids. And then I can move each tiny solid by its dynamics. So then, like, I can get one global solution for this flow. And knowing that flow, I can solve for each particle velocity v. And that is a gross simplification.
So while you're working on different questions or different problems, you have to use a mix of all these different assumptions to get different equations. So, and some questions you may be just using Navier-Stokes equation.
Absolutely.
While in some you will be using my Maxey-Riley.
Yeah, and there'll be situations where Maxey-Riley is wrong. There'll be situations where I can get away with an even simpler form of Maxey-Riley. There'll be things like that. So the thing is that every time you make an assumption in fluid mechanics, you make also errors. And sometimes those errors can become very big somewhere or other in the flow. And that is called in fluid mechanics as a singular problem. So where, you know, you think you're dropping a small term, but the error you're getting is big. So we have to keep watching out for those things. So when we make assumptions, we have to keep questioning those assumptions. So like the whole idea is that, you know, you try to write the simplest form of solutions possible. So in my group, for example, we try to do this. We write the simplest form of the equations possible. We try to write some version which can be solved analytically. And then like we solve for a more complicated flow numerically with big scale computations. But we will see whether that big scale computation reduces to this analytical answer in some limit. So we will do numerics, which will reduce to the analytical answer in some limit to confirm. And then we will use the analytical answer in various blob portions of the fluid to reduce our numerical simulations by substituting these analytical answers. So like we have to try a whole bunch of tricks to solve for any flow.
So I didn't get that. What are the different stages of, so you said it's one is analytical, one is computational.
Okay, let me give you an example. Let me just not do Bassett history, but Bassett history is a bit complicated to understand. But let's do this example on caustics. So what happens is that if I have these particles in the fluid and I write even a simplified version of Maxey-Riley, I told you the fluid is full of vortices, right? These rotating parts, these blues and all are vortices in the fluid. Now, this blue gives the magnitude of the vorticity color. So now in the fluid, I have these vortices going around, and then I have these particles going around, and the Maxey-Riley effectively gives centrifugal action for these heavy particles. So they get thrown out of these regions in the fluid which are rotating. So imagine that I've got a 3D fluid where I've taken a 2D slice. Here I'm solving a 2D equation, but I've taken a plane, one plane, and I'm seeing what's happening there. So you will see that particles get thrown out due to Maxey-Riley from this these vortices. So we said, okay, like, you know, can I go simpler than that? And in order to understand raindrop growth in this particular example. So we said, can we go simpler than that? And we said, okay, forget this very complicated stuff. Oops. Even in this thing, even this flow is very, very complicated for us because the different vortices are moving each other, different portions of the fluid is moving different other portions of the fluid. So the vortices are mutually inducing each other to do certain things. All kinds of complications are going on. And, you know, these particles are following very complicated paths, which are not easy for me to understand. So let's go to one vortex. Let's go to this one vortex and try to understand what's going on. So in this one vortex, that vortex is seen by that little black ring. And we said that vortex is going to stay the same for all time. So that is called a Lambosine vortex. And at high Reynolds number, it's kind of a perfect solution of the Navier-Stokes. It's a, you know, I know everything about the vorticity. I know everything about the velocity. So I know this whole velocity field for all time. And then I release particles in it and I make them go with simplified Maxey Riley. I'm calling this analytical. It's only semi-analytical. I'm just reducing it to an ordinary differential equation, a bunch of ordinary differential equations instead of this very complicated partial differential equation. I do that and then I release all these particles in it and I ask where they go. So here we asked one specific question. The specific question we asked is, if I'm close to the vortex, I'll get centrifuged out very fast. If I'm far away from the vortex, I'll get centrifuged out slowly. So can the guy who's coming from inside the inside region overtake the outside region and go past him? And if this guy can go past the other particle, can they both dash against each other and collide and therefore coalesce into a bigger blob? So we asked this question and we could do this, like we could show a lot of things analytically for this. So we could show that whoever started out in the green color, all the green colored particles who started out near the vortex, within a special neighborhood of the vortex, they can dash against others and they can coalesce with some probability to make even bigger drops. And these bigger drops centrifuge out even faster. So they leave the vortex even faster. Whereas the red guys don't do anything. They just go slowly. They become, you know, denser. They form a denser and denser disk. That's all.
So blue drops are a few green drops coming together?
Yes. Blue. We color a guy blue if he has any amount of red, green blood. So like if they have some greens merging with red, that's also blue. And green merging with green, that's also blue. But red merging with red is red. And you don't see those at all.
Okay.
So that's how we've colored them. And so analytically, we could show the existence of this special radius. We could show everything that's happening in the neighborhood of a vortex. So this could now be our building block for simulating turbulence. If you see what I mean? I just put the neighborhood, I put the known solutions in the neighborhood of the vortex. That way I don't have to solve for millions and millions of particles everywhere. So I could think of simplifying ways to solve for, you know, billions and billions of particles, which no computer can do, by building back from my, you know, building block answers to the main one. So this is some kind of, simplification that we try to do. So we wrote like several papers on this. There was this student, Kroor, we call him Kroor, but his real name is Ravichandran. He did his PhD on this kind of thing. And Jason Picardo was a postdoc with us, who's now a faculty in IIT Bombay. So these two people studied like many, many aspects of just particles centrifuging out of vortical regions. So is this example making it clear, like how we try to simplify?
Yes.
This is only one example. We've done like a whole variety of things which are totally unrelated to each other.
So have you also went on a helicopter and bombed a mountain?
Unfortunately, no. But I don't think it's unfortunate. I don't want to do that experiment. I would like to go on a plane which measures rain clouds. But till now, I haven't had the courage to go on it because the turbulence is incredible. It's a small plane. And you're like, normally when you fly in a big plane also, the pilot will, you know, avoid very cloudy regions. He or she will try to fly through regions which are less turbulent. But clouds are extremely turbulent. And if you want to do these measurements, you have to fly through a cloud. So although I have friends who are willing to take me on these rides, till now I've not gone. But if somebody of you want to do like projects like this in our group, you can get these opportunities. We have like lots of tie-ups where we can go on cruises in ships to measure things in the ocean and so on. So if I go to the last page here, I don't want to, you know, show you all these things. They're all too many. Yeah, on this page, there is Ritabrat here. He's my ex-PhD student who is on a ship in the Bay of Bengal. And Kroor has gone on a cruise. Ganga has gone on a cruise. And we have open invitations to fly in those aircraft. So there's many kinds of things we can do, and we can combine those actual measurements with simple analytical understanding as well as complicated numerical solutions and get a whole bunch of results. Does this answer your question?
Yes.
And what other questions do you have?
So basically the bottom line of all these things is the Navier-Stokes equation. And then Whichever system do we want to study, we make assumptions and we make simplifications, either in theory or in experiment based on that. But then that equation still remains true in all these scenarios, right?
Absolutely. So it's the Navier-Stokes equation. It could have like very complicated moving boundary conditions with different, you know, solids moving very complicatedly through it. It could have a whole mess of unbelievable time-varying boundary conditions. But finally, the equation is the Navier-Stokes. We've made like many assumptions even to reach here. For example, we've said the viscosity is a constant. If it was not constant, like if temperature varies from place A to place B, we'd have to improve this term. So it wouldn't be quite the same Navier-Stokes. If there was heavy fluid on light fluid, there would be gravity effects, like density would appear explicitly in this equation, and we would have to include more terms. So this is the simplest thing you can do for a homogeneous isothermal fluid of one viscosity and one density, and whose viscosity is a constant. There are some fluids whose viscosity itself inherently depends on pressure, or whose viscosity inherently depends on the rate at which you're shearing, like polymeric solutions. So for such things, this equation will not be valid. The other thing is that I've said it's incompressible. Del dot U is zero. Whereas if I think of, you know, air, which I'm pumping into, for example, into a cycle wheel or something, I keep pumping more and more and more air into it. And then the incompressibility condition fails. So these equations are valid in a broad range of situations, but not in all situations. In some situations, we have to let go of these equations themselves and write better equations. And then our game is to simplify, not just do blind numerics. Our game is to simplify it, do patchwork. And that's the bottom line.
So when you do cloud-related experiments and studies, so clouds are also compressible, right? So you can't relax that.
Clouds are practically incompressible.
Okay.
You can actually derive and show that if your speeds that you're dealing with are much, much smaller than the speed of sound, and you're not doing bizarro things like pumping, you can actually make this assumption for clouds. It's a very, very good assumption for clouds. Because all speeds are much lower than the speed of sound. So compressibility effects are negligible. Other questions that you have?
So what does compressibility mean?
Compressibility means like I'm putting more and more and more fluid into the same volume. I can stuff more and more and more fluid into the same volume. And technically with air, I can do that. Like, you know, actually air is compressible because, you know, I can increase the pressure and I can put more volume and that will increase the pressure. So by ideal gas law, like if I put, you know, if my N by V, that means the number of molecules in a given volume keeps on increasing, it will increase the pressure, but I can put more molecules in the same volume. But unless I'm doing this forcibly in normal flows, like that doesn't happen. In normal flows, typically the number of molecules per unit volume is fairly constant throughout the dynamics. So this is a very, very simplifying assumption I can make. But My speeds are close to the speed of sound. For example, like a supersonic aircraft, I'm looking at flow in the neighborhood of a supersonic aircraft. Then like no way on earth I can do this. I'll have to solve much more complicated equations than this.
Okay. And is there an easy way to I mean, rationalize why clouds are incompressible, almost incompressible.
Yeah, so you can actually derive a condition that changes in the net density are small when speeds are much smaller than the speed of sound.
The speed of the particles. Speed of the water vapor particles.
The speed of the blobs. Speed of the blobs. Each molecule is going at root kt.
Right. But
the
cloud blobs.
Yeah, like, you know, if I say wind is moving at 10 meter per second. So yes. That is like, you know, on an average, particles are moving, on an average, the entire blob is moving forward at 10 meter per second, where I've removed out the portion which is randomized. I'm taking the average velocity of a whole blob. In that, if that average velocity is much smaller than the speed of sound, which is not true for a supersonic aircraft, for the neighborhood of a supersonic aircraft. Or it's not true for a rocket which is coming back to the Earth. So for those conditions, I cannot just say, oh, that is also Navier-Stokes. That is like some kind of modified Navier-Stokes, you might want to call it. But yeah, like this particular form of the Navier-Stokes gets modified in many ways, and this incompressibility condition has to be let go, and we have to solve the, you know, compressible Navier-Stokes with the proper compressibility condition for mass balance, mass conservation.
Thank you.
Ma'am, you had said that there was a minimal size of vortices and some turbulence factors with respect to particle size. So if I remove the temporal factor from this equation, does it limit my modeling size of the system? So I cannot study vortices. I cannot take my model inside the vortices or something like that.
If you remove this term, this equation will be fundamentally wrong. You can't do that. This term is actually big. See, like I have A plus B equal to C plus D, right? Only if A is much, much smaller than B, C, and D, I can do that. But that's not going to be the case. Except, you know, when the body has reached terminal velocity or something like that. Typically, in turbulence, this is never the case. So I cannot neglect this term. But what was the other part of your question?
It was, if we remove, can we, say, model, does it limit my continuity or say the minimal size of the system that I can model?
No. So like the minimal size of the system depends on other parameters, and this depends on other parameters. So in general, in a turbulent flow, you can never remove this. Is that answering your question?
Yes.
More questions?
But in a highly viscous... So in a highly viscous situation, we can ignore the del by del t term, right? Then we can only have those other two, like how we had in the Stokes, the ball.
Yeah. So this is what I was trying to tell you. When viscosity is, let's say, infinite, which makes Reynolds number zero, correct?
Yes.
When viscosity is infinite and Reynolds number, if viscosity is technically infinite, and Reynolds number is technically zero, I can write this equal to, I can write this equal to this. I can even throw away this term. But that never happens, because the minute I have a U, I have a Reynolds number, because this tiny U goes into that Reynolds. So this, even when viscosity is very, very large, this thing becomes a quantity. And I mean, in other words, if the Reynolds was exactly zero, there's no point equating this term to this term, because both become infinite. But that isn't the case. You have a velocity u, which then I balance with these terms. So in any particle which is in perfectly steady flow, yes, I can simplify it by throwing away this term and this term. And when the Reynolds number is small, but not very, very small, I can actually include this term, which can be big, but still neglect that term, because it's a quadratic term in U. So if U is very small, I can say if U is equal to epsilon, then I'm saying epsilon square is much, much smaller than epsilon. And that's how I went to unsteady Stokes from Navier-Stokes.
Yes, ma'am.
Other questions?
Again, like I'm sort of confused about what's the difficulty in actually understanding turbulence. So it's just mathematical problem, right? That we cannot solve this differential equation exactly.
Yes. We cannot solve the differential equation exactly. We cannot solve the differential equation numerically to any accuracy by modern day computers. Most likely, unless we get some very fancy, you know, some very big quantum jump in computing, like by quantum computing or something like that. Unless we get some huge leap in that, we can't solve bigger flows realistically. So I had some slide on that. Let me show you. Yeah. So as you go, you know, bigger and bigger in Reynolds number, this thing becomes, you know, more and more and more fine scaled. So the ratio of the large scale to the fine scale becomes larger and larger and larger. And then I need to have a grid. You know, I can't solve a differential equation on the computer without discretizing it, right? So I have to solve it on a grid. And if I want to, you know, get a grid which is small enough to be smaller than the smallest vortex, then I need more and more and more points in my grid. And the biggest simulation of turbulence now is woefully inadequate, woefully small compared to these clouds and things like that. So, like, in other words, I cannot solve Navier-Stokes for large Reynolds numbers in the foreseeable future. Because, like, what happens is that the scale, the whole nature of turbulence keeps changing as you increase the Reynolds. So like as the nature changes, you have to keep increasing the grids. And as I increase the grids, I quickly run out of compute power, whatever be my computer, even if I have lakhs of cores running for a year. So that's why the world's largest simulation is this much today. And this is woefully inadequate. It'll form in, it'll be this little patch of cloud that I'll be solving. And I'll be putting artificial boundary conditions for that. And so like, I cannot solve it. I cannot resolve it. And this thing is without particles. With particles, I'm finished. I'm like completely finished. So like, if I want to resolve the flow behind the particle, which is at some significant Reynolds number, I'm already in trouble there. So like the one thing that people do is this thing called large eddy simulations, where they say, I know that my smallest grid can never resolve my little scales. So I will solve for the big scales, and for the tiny vortices, I'll put some average forcing. So like, because of this non-linear term, because of my non-linear term in the Navier-Stokes, the small scales force the large scales and the large scales force the small scales. So there is forcing from every scale to every other scale, even if I try to Fourier transform it and solve it. So what I'll do is I'll solve for the big scales exactly. And for the small scales, like these are called sub-grid scales. If my grid is very big, then what's happening inside a grid? I'll put some average force based on the properties of that particular grid, based on the gradients and velocities and pressures in that particular grid. I will have this thing. This is called large eddy simulations. So people conduct large eddy simulations on clouds and things, which are not exact solutions of the Navier-Stokes. They are Navier-Stokes with artificial forcing. And that artificial forcing is given by experience and, you know, massaging, like semi-empirical things, lot of such things. It's not a pakka forcing that's given.
Also, like, are we entirely sure that all the physics of turbulence is contained in the Navier-Stokes equation?
So like basically we've derived it carefully from first principles. We've made some assumptions on the way, such as viscosity is constant, which need not be the case. Like in a general fluid, it need not be the case. So under those assumptions, it's been verified time and again, time and again, time and again. You know, experiments and theory compare very well. Experiments and simulations at smaller Reynolds number compare very well. We can solve this pretty well, pretty exactly in today's computers for reasonably high Reynolds numbers, like 1,000, 10,000. Those are very easy to solve. Not very easy, but you need this. I mean, on the biggest computers, they're easy to solve. And those have been compared to experiment in some detail, and they satisfy So like the two things we have in our favor is that we derive these from Newton's laws without making too many assumptions or knowing the assumptions we made. And then under those assumptions, we are matching numerical solutions with the experiment. So basically we can say the Navier-Stokes are describing fluid flow exactly.
Yes.
But whether something even more bizarre is coming at extremely high Reynolds numbers, nobody has checked it. Like on the planetary scale for a sun or something, nobody can do simulations. All the non-dimensional numbers they use are wrong. So they can never compare to observations one-to-one because they cannot do those simulations.
Yes.
So in astrophysical fluid dynamics, there's even more assumptions you make. There's like severely gross assumptions you make. But again, you solve something like this. What you finally solve is something like the Navier-Stokes.
What do you think about the interdisciplinary nature of your work? You just mentioned, I think, astrophysics, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So where else do you think this work is can be relevant in other fields of science?
Okay, so there is no field of science which can go which can run independently without fluid mechanics. Mm-hmm. That's my take on it. Like if you want to understand any problem correctly, you will need fluid mechanics. The point is that take anything. So normally when I talk about fluid mechanics to young students, I begin by asking them to name like one sport where fluid mechanics is not important.
Yes, yes.
And you know that almost nothing, like, okay, chess or something, but in all those things, fluid mechanics is important. In any earth system, you want to understand climate at any level, fluid mechanics is important. You want to understand any life form, like dynamics of fishes, how they reproduce, how they evolve. You cannot escape from fluid mechanics. You want to understand about, of course, astrophysics. You can't live without fluid mechanics. You can't go anywhere without it. You want to understand chemistry at some deep level. So you want to understand what's going on in a reactor. You have to do fluid mechanics there. And I will even generalize fluid mechanics to say transport phenomena. So like I have to understand mass transfer, you know, things like that to solve any chemistry problems very exactly. So biology, chemistry, I don't see like a field where you don't need this, which is why I think it's a great pity that it's not taught in detail to undergraduates. Yes. Because they're going to need it at every stage of their research life. Or let me say it another way. If they knew fluid mech, they could think broader about a whole bunch of problems. And they could bring, you know, a whole bunch of problems. So that's one side of the interdisciplinarity that, you know, almost no one can escape from fluid mechanics. The other aspect is how many kinds of people do you need to work together on these problems? So like I work together with oceanographers. I have no idea about, you know, a very poor idea about how they design particular instruments to measure particular things, how they back out, you know, sensible answers from very complicated readings in the ocean. And then like, I have no idea how, you know, these radar people back out, you know, droplet distributions. But so like if, you know, people who are experts in, you know, radar things, people who are experts in ocean instruments, people who are experts in climate science. I'm a zero in climate science, or let me say epsilon tending to zero. All of those things, like people of those trainings need to talk to each other. In fact, I think like we have to talk to people who know geography in order to understand, solve some of these problems. So there is nobody left. And if you take the topic of climate, I think it's even wrong to say only scientists can solve that problem. It's a problem which has, you know, politics, economics, human endeavor, everything coming in and coloring the answers. So everybody has to talk to everybody in all of these things. For example, if a government decides to merge two rivers or link two rivers, they have to talk to ecologists, they have to talk to fluid mechanicians, they have to talk to climate scientists. Like, you know, if you merge these two rivers and the water is not going to the ocean and you're using up all the water that was going to the ocean for yourself, will you get rain next year? Like, is the water being disgorged into the ocean important for next year's rain? Things like that. Like, you know, you have to talk to a variety of people and do a variety of very complicated calculations. And at the end, because these are very non-linear, your answers will be colored by errors. So these are things that you have to be very careful on, like what claims you're making and how far you can go to predict something. Like, you should never overclaim these things. And yeah, like, everything is interdisciplinary in the modern world. Like, never go into science thinking that you'll only study one corner of it. You may have to, I mean, you cannot be expert in many corners, but you have to know enough to be able to talk to people from other corners and get input from them. And that's when you can define bigger problems and solve bigger problems. I think the times when you could stick in one little corner and keep working are gone. I mean, gone means there's still some such subjects, but for the most part, like, most scientists have to talk to people outside their field of expertise.
So do you think, so I'm personally, being a biologist, I was wondering, like you said, it is definitely there in many fields and nobody can really escape from these or looking at problems from this perspective. But yeah. Do you think people are actually doing that, or are there people, you know, who are, even though it is not being trained in the initial years or something, are there people who are doing it?
There's more and more and more people who are doing it.
Okay.
In the world at large, like, less in India, but more and more and more people are, even in India, it's quite a lot now compared to before. People are, like, walking out of their comfort zone and talking to others and solving problems. For example, like, of the order of 20 years ago, there was a group of doctors who had called in these aerospace engineers. And this happened when I was visiting Berkeley, and a bunch of aerospace guys in Berkeley were asked to solve this problem. So the problem was that, you know, and this was like 20 years ago. So, like, you know, you have a tube, which is basically an artery or something, okay? And there's blood flowing through this artery. Now, in one patient's case, the artery is like 1% blocked or 5% blocked. And for another patient, it's like 99% blocked. So the doctors tell the 99% guy, like, you're going to die if we don't do surgery on you. So right now you need a bypass. And that guy says no money, and he runs away, and he's alive like for 20 years after that. Whereas the guy who had 5%, the doctor said, go home, it's only 5%. Suddenly in 2 months, you know, the block grew so much and he died. So this kind of thing, they asked aerospace engineers to solve, like, you know, flow through flexible tubes, and can you tell, like, when, what kind of, you know, solid deposition will happen in what kind of situation. So you need somebody who understands flow separation at a fundamental level, namely an aerospace engineer who can actually solve these problems. So yeah, you need to know who to go to and how to solve. And with AI coming in, you can do so much simplification. A lot of this Navier-Stokes can be replaced by a lot of the building blocks we're trying to build, may be replaced by AI tools, learning algorithms, and we may be able to solve bigger and bigger flows in coming years. So yeah, I mean, we have to talk to computer scientists, we have to talk to everybody.
So as a curious person, do you, when you see around yourself, you might get a lot of questions. So do you have this urge to, you know, get answers to everything? And if so, what does the scientist inside you tell, like, say?
So, like, yes, I look around and I keep getting million questions every day. A brilliant place to get questions, everybody, is the kitchen. So if you want to do, you know, food, fluid mechanics, like just contact me, I can give you problems to do long distance, which you can, but then I want like proper, commitment to this. So there's like million fluid mech questions in the kitchen, which I would love to solve. You walk on the street, you'll see questions like look at a tree. You ask like, why is the bark cracked up in a certain way? Why do you see patterns there? Why do you see leaves which are broken up in a certain way? There's questions like everywhere you walk on a macroscopic scale. I need not go to some very small scales, which I can't see with my eye. Those are beautiful as well, but I don't have to do that in order to get science questions. So a lot of these science questions I've played with summer students, with short-term students, and we've got some partial understanding and been happy with that. We've not published most of those things. So for example, if you take wine in a wine glass and you're trying to pour it into a glass, like why does it sometimes go down the side of the bottle and fall on the floor, spill on the floor, whereas sometimes you're able to pour it neatly? So there's like, that thing is called the Coanda effect. You can ask, why are stalactites and stalagmites growing at a certain rate in limestone caves? You can ask about glaciers. You can ask about, like this big avalanche that happened, rock avalanche that happened a few days ago in the Himalayas. You can ask about tsunami. How destructive is a particular tsunami going to be? So these things like train you for a very wide range of questions. Does that answer your question, Sanskriti?
Yeah. So what, do you feel bad about not being able to pursue a lot of your questions?
Yeah. But I also feel good that if I live till 90 also, I have questions to ask. I won't like reach my office one day wake up one day and think, oh, like all the problems are solved and everything is known and there's no paper I can write or there's nothing I can do. That will never happen. You will also come to that stage one day. Like initially it will be like, oh, I got this idea, but somebody has solved it. I got this idea, but somebody has solved it. This is the kind of thing that happens initially, that you feel everything is already solved and there's nothing to do. But later in life, you realize that that's so not the case. Like pick up anything and you'll find so many things which are not done. And these were some examples I showed you, just how a vortex centrifuges out a particle. It's so easy to write those equations and solve them exactly. And that is not understood. So many things in that are not understood, that we could write like 5 or 6 papers on that very topic. So yes, like nobody has infinite time, but people can collaborate with people and solve like a variety of problems. Anything else?
Any other question? Anybody has any questions, you can unmute.
I have a question on monsoons. So yeah. In what way studying Indian monsoon is different from studying rainfall anywhere else in general?
Okay, so there's many, many things that distinguish the Indian monsoon. First of all, it's the largest amount, it's the most heavy rain concentrated into 4 months. So like if you compare, let's say some European city or European place, you'll get like some rain every month typically. And all the 12 months will be very similar to each other. Whereas here we have like very dry season followed by a sudden jump in rainfall. The onset is so dramatic, like within a week, everything changes. Like in a few weeks, the, cracked up soil is full of vegetation. So the whole thing is so sudden. Why is the onset so sudden? That's only in this part. If you look at the way, the cloud band moves, the cloud band itself moves north and south because of, you know, the angle the earth makes. So, like around the year, the earth, different portions of the earth get hotter and colder, right? Like there's a northern hemisphere summer and a southern hemisphere summer. And wherever there is a hotter place, the cloud band moves there, because wherever air is lighter, it rises better, and any rising typically ends up in clouds. But this thing is not, you know, uniform across the equator or across the all the longitudes. Basically, the Indian landmass, the clouds move much further north than anywhere else. So the Himalayas and these things, the Western Ghats, these things make a big difference to how the dynamics of our monsoon compared to others. Then the oceans are very different from other oceans. The Bay of Bengal is very, very low salinity in its top layers. And that makes the response time of the bay much shorter than that of the Arabian Sea. So that's because many rivers bring fresh water into the bay. So the, you know, this somehow affects the monsoon, but we don't know how. So there's a lot of, you know, neighborhood stuff that's going on. And when you run climate models, the climate models have parameters. Like I told you, you do things like very large eddy simulations where you model all the small scales. So on the global scale, it's done even worse. Like the grids are very, very big. So like all the parameterization and all the guesswork is not based on the Indian monsoon. It's based on, you know, other measurements in Western places. So because the parameterization is wrong, the answers are wrong. Like the predictions are wrong. Although they solve like complicated Navier-Stokes equation on as big a grid as possible, it still goes wrong. Every year, we don't know what's going to happen in the monsoon and stuff like that. Does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Can phenomena happening in a small region, say 5 square kilometers, affect the monsoon?
Yeah, we don't know that they cannot. They might well affect the monsoon. That's what, like when we take all small scales to be every other small scale and we're putting back a common forcing from small scales to big scales, we may be doing an error there. We know that the 5 kilometer guy is going to affect the monsoon on an average, and we have some average way of dealing with that called the subgrid forcing. But we don't know whether different, I mean, we don't know enough about how different kinds of forcing at smaller scales is going to affect things at larger scale. All scales talk to each other because it's a nonlinear problem. And in any chaotic system, you know that if you want a specific trajectory of a system, you will always go wrong at some time scale, right? Like you've studied about chaos? Raise hands.
No.
Okay. Basically, any chaotic system, and turbulence is an, you know, is a kind of ultimate chaotic system, next only to life or something. A small change in initial conditions will change the final answer by a big number. So that's why they say, you know, like, whether a butterfly flaps its wings in Jaipur will determine whether it's going to rain in Jamaica. So small change in initial conditions can change specifics of the answer.
So, ma'am, I was asking, you must be depending on, so like you mentioned, all these oceanographers and other people that one has to collaborate with to answer your question. So you must be having a lot of dependency, because how do you actually get the data? Your PhD students who have gone to all these programs.
Yeah, so we are dependent on them for the data. We do have collaborations for the data. So in the situations where we need other people's data, we have collaborations. In some of these situations, like we can solve the problem theoretically, or we have some corner which we can solve on our own. And there, like to just get the physical understanding, we may not need elaborate data. And then there's also data available on the internet, a lot of, you know, rainfall data, satellite, so many measurements by satellites are freely available, all of that. So you need a combination of everything. But it's not just for data that you need friends and collaborators, it's for understanding from their perspective. They bring something intellectual to the table, not just measurements.
Okay, right.
Yeah. Any examples about this? I mean, how you gained from the wisdom of your collaborators in other fields.
Okay, so why don't I go back to the work of Ritavrat? I couldn't talk about all these people's work, but doesn't matter. So this guy Ritavrat, what happened was that we went into a collaboration with, we were in a big conglomerate which was going to do things in the Bay of Bengal. And in that big group of people, there were like Indians and Americans. And we were so lucky to find this group in Oregon State University. Like normally it would not even be a university I would visit or I would know anything about. But there is this absolute, like two absolute genius oceanographers there. One is called Emily Schreuer and one is called Jim Moom. So like in this Bay of Bengal meeting, we actually met these people and we, okay, I mean, with some discussions, we matched up with each other and realized we can answer some questions in the Bay of Bengal. So Jim Moom has invented this instrument called the Chi pod, like Chi hyphen pod, the Greek letter Chi, which measures turbulence in the ocean. So with his expertise, like our group measured we made the first measurements of turbulence in the Bay of Bengal. And Ritabrat did a lot of analysis on this measurement and he found out that suddenly like turbulence is dying in the Bay of Bengal at a depth of about 50 meters. That reading is suddenly becoming laminar. Whereas like I just told you that all large scale flow is turbulent, right? But we're getting laminar flow and it's staying laminar for 4 months. Like somewhere when the fresh water from the monsoon arrives, it, like in June, July, August, it becomes laminar and it stays laminar till December or something. So this was one very amazing finding in the bay that we got and we don't understand it. So now we are employing all kinds of theory. So me and Ritabrat and one more student who was with me for 1 year and he's now doing his PhD in Cornell University called Arjun Sharma. So we three are looking at, you know, very sophisticated stability tools to understand this stabilization of the laminar flow or re-laminarization that we are seeing. So this is one example where such an amazing finding, which everybody is amazed by. We had never got it without, you know, somebody who knows how to measure it, somebody who spent 20, 30 years measuring it. So they measured, you know, turbulence in many other places before, but not in the bay. Is that a good example of a collaboration? One more collaboration I can tell is right on this picture. So this guy, Eric Esman, was my joint PhD student. He actually graduated from the University of Edinburgh, but he was a student of mine and a faculty member there in Edinburgh called Prashant Valluri. And this guy would spend 6 months in India, 6 months in Edinburgh. So he went and came about 3 times. So this is how he did his PhD. And in this problem, there was a question I had on ellipsoids in fluid, high Reynolds number fluid. And like there were some nice theorems and all which were given long ago. And when I was a postdoctoral fellow, like which was 1994, about 27 years ago, I had this question in my mind about, you know, what would happen in a real viscous fluid and how we could do simulations to understand some things about these ellipsoids. And I was never able to do it for many decades, like 2 decades, until one day I told, so Prashant, this guy's advisor, Prashant Valluri was, I met him by chance in an American Physical Society meeting, like just on the sidelines of the conference, like, hi, hello, what do you do type thing. And he told me that he has this code which can solve Navier-Stokes for moving bodies. And that's an amazing thing. Like it's already, even now it's very difficult to get this kind of Navier-Stokes solutions. And although the Reynolds number was modest, like 10,000, I said, I have the perfect problem where I know the theory and I know everything, but I'd want to get a real numerical solution. So he provided the numerics and I provided the theory and we made a very nice understanding. We could actually like understand the theorem better, understand the implications of the theorems better, and you know, show how like theorems which are made in the absence of viscosity hold with viscosity. A lot of nice things came out. And Chajwa's PhD thesis was also a beautiful collaboration with Narayanan Menon and Sri Ram Ramaswamy. This guy's PhD, same thing. Kroor and me and Eckhart Myberg in UC Santa Barbara, we've done some good collaborations. Yeah, like in each case, they couldn't have done without me and I couldn't have done without them. And finally, you know, like somebody spends 3 years working on a problem and they're willing to coach you on that problem in 3 hours. So like very quickly you come up to steam in something they are an expert in, and they come up to steam in something we are an expert in. And these two things can quickly combine to become something bigger. And Emily and Jim are not fluid mechanicians per se. So if they want to understand like fundamentally what's happening with the stability of this, why should something relaminarize, that will be our job. We haven't yet started our job in the collaboration. Although like Ritabrat and I to some extent, but mainly Ritabrat did learn how to pull out reasonable things from the data. So we did do some data manipulations to understand that this phenomenon is happening in the first place. So we had to do some work on it, but till now the real fluid mech hasn't started on it. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, let me ask a general question. Like, how many of you would be interested in doing some problem in your PhD, wherever in the world you do it, related to climate? How many of you are strongly interested in working on climate?
I am quite interested in.
Okay, I see 2 hands and 4 hands. Are these all hands? I see many hands. Vatsal, Atif, Rushikesh, Avni. I see 4 hands there. And also Sanskriti. That's good. So like a lot of you are interested in such problems. Then like it will be nice if you learn some fluid mech, but at the same time keep learning about climate. There's many ways to make contributions to climate without knowing fluid mech. So Shri Raj is asking how to raise his hand. Can someone help him? Or has he gone away?
You can click on the reaction button.
I am here. I just wanted to raise hand, but
okay. Okay, so are you also interested in climate things?
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. So to you guys, I can tell that there is a, by the way, this is my present group of PhD students. So after Eric finished his PhD, while Eric was working with me, Davide also got interested in this joint thing. And he also came to India and worked, but then because of the pandemic, Andrew couldn't come, and Davide also couldn't come a second time. But what was the question I was answering? Sorry. Yeah, about your interest in climate, I was going to tell you that ICTS, the place where I work, has a very good set of lectures by Raghu Murthugudde on climate, which was given last summer, and that's available on YouTube. So I would strongly encourage you to look at that, to watch those lectures, those who are interested. It will give you at least some idea of the enormity of it. He ran a mini course actually, I think over 3 weeks.
Yeah, we can share the link to that.
Okay.
To all the people who, or maybe in the chat right now. Yeah.
I was in fact about to ask you, where do mathematicians come into picture in solving any kind of environmental problem, working on those kind of problems?
So like my colleague Vishal Vasan is a mathematician. He's an amazingly good mathematician. And without his help, we couldn't have solved this problem on Bassett history, which I didn't talk about, but now that you ask a question, where does a mathematician come in? I'll tell you this and you'll understand ki, like as a fluid mechanician, I couldn't have done it. I needed him. I needed his brilliance to do this. So I told you that, you know, a flow, I mean, basically, if I want to understand how a small sphere is moving through a fluid, and if I know the fluid velocity u, how do I find the particle velocity v? And that is given by this Maxey-Rayleigh equation. So let's for a minute call w equal to v minus u, the velocity difference between particle and fluid, okay? There is this term in the Maxey-Rayleigh equation which is so unbelievably complicated. It's the time derivative of v minus u divided by root of t minus s, where s is a running variable, integrated from my time equal to minus infinity to just now. At every time instant, I have to remember the entire history of this particle, where all it went and what was the difference in accelerations of fluid and particle, that is w dot. And then I have to integrate over every time instant over its entire history. And that will force, you know, because the way the fluid has moved depends on the history, that is going to provide a force on this particle. And normally, like all fluid mechanicians, just neglect that force, okay? They just say, we can't do this for each particle, so neglect it even if the neglect is unjustified. And the reason that you have this complicated expression is because it's a half derivative in time. It's a fractional derivative. So d half w by dt half. So it's a half derivative in time, which is the Bassett, one part of the Bassett history force is given by this. Now, Vishal's idea was the following. He said dw by dt, a full derivative of w, is actually d half by dt half of d half w by dt half, right? Two half derivatives, two fractional derivatives of half half make the full derivative. So he wrote this heat equation. He said dw by dt is d square w by dx square. So d half w by dt half, which is this quantity h, is actually a full derivative in x. Are you following this? Sanskriti?
Yes.
Ah, so then this was a brilliant idea, which, like, you know, unless you're thinking mathematically, you'll never think it. So then, like, you know, you can solve the heat equation for each particle and you don't have to go back all through history. You can replace your knowledge of this thing by a few Fourier modes in X. And then he had like this amazing transform method, which is, you know, where you transform, it's like a Fourier transform, but it's an amazing amazingly better transform for space and time together. It's called the unified transform method. He used that and showed how to solve this thing. And we could solve for this Bassett history. I told you at the beginning that I'll come back to this exponential thing. We could solve analytically for this falling particle, including Bassett history. And we showed that the velocity goes like t to the, terminal velocity is reached as fast as 1 over root t, not e exponential. So that exponential expression is completely wrong and it's been used for over a century, for 170 years. So we actually found out, you know, the first analytical solution of the Maxey-Rayleigh equation. Analytical solutions in many things. And without, you know, a mathematician on the in the group, we couldn't have done it. Yes.
So how did this happen? How did the this t to the power half came?
How did the t to the power half come? Okay, the t to the power half comes for the same reason that there is, you know, diffusion in the problem. So like it's no magic. Like now we are expanding it in another fictitious variable x, but there's another variable, space variable, in which this is happening. So why it's happening is that there is this particle which is going in flow, and flow is got diffusive viscous effects, right? So the way the viscosity acts on this particle depends on the shear force, and the shear force is the first derivative. The shear force is given by the first derivative in x. So like the shear force over all the history is basically first derivative in x, which actually like manifests itself as a half derivative in time here. But if you've forgotten where it came from, you'll not understand it. But this is a standard expression for the half derivative. So like if you if you know Cauchy's formula for integral and all, instead of the 1 over n factorial or whatever you write, you can write gamma functions and you can get the half derivative expressions like this. You can get any derivative like dxw by dt x, where x is any number. You can get the expression for that derivative. So the half derivative came about for a perfectly physical reason.
Okay.
In fact, like my student Ganga and I were, you know, planning to do this Bassett history term, include it numerically and do it by this complicated numerical method. And we were arguing about what's the best way to go about it when Vishal just walked into the room, he sat on the sofa and said, "What are you guys talking about?" And that became a very nice paper, and it's going to become, you know, an important part of Divya's thesis. So yeah, like when you talk to different people with different interests, you get many things out of it. Other questions?
Do we have any more questions?
I'm stopping my sharing.
Yes. Does anyone have any more questions?
Ma'am,
Avni, maybe you can go first.
Yes, okay. Ma'am, there is this phenomena called the El Nino effect.
Yes.
Where a band of warm water develops in the ocean. So in that case, it's like the entire water body would be having a different temperature and that band would be having a different temperature.
No, no, it's not like that. See, okay, finish your question. I'll tell you the thing.
So I was saying there's this band of water with raised temperature, basically. So, and you said that the equations that you use in most of them are dependent on temperature and things change when temperature changes. So how would that complicate things?
Okay, okay. So the thing is, El Nino is a special phenomenon where, you know, the water temperature changes by, you know, it becomes a little warmer than other years. So like somewhere on the Central American coast, this happens, that compared to other years, you get like a half degree drop or something. It's a very small drop or increase. And one of them is an El Nino and the other is a La Nina. And because there is this temperature change, like the there are, you know, circulation set up because there's lighter fluid in one place. So ocean circulation goes this way and wind circulation goes that way. So it pulls a lot of the, it pulls some of the monsoon winds to itself on in that direction. So that has effect on the Indian monsoon. So similarly, the La Nina, because it's higher, it weakens the pulling and we get stronger monsoon. So yeah, this is a very trivialized explanation. It's there's way more complicated stuff going on there. So so yes, a small amount of temperature can change the convection patterns because, you know, flow goes from high potential or high pressure to low pressure, and these things can change those answers. So in other words, like if I have a slightly warmer parcel of air, it will move upwards because it's lighter, and then air from the sides will rush in. So I will get, you know, a big circulation happening in the atmosphere. So these things can happen due to small, like 1 degree change in temperature. It need not be like a huge change.
Are these the same reason why you have hurricane seasons and like the Florida coast and like in specific places? Are these, is this contributing to that reason?
That so the, I mean, not specifically El Nino, but generalized climate behavior does create hurricanes. It all forms due to generalized, like small changes in pressure and temperature. Mm. I mean, it's a chicken and egg problem. Like if you have wind, I mean, flow in a certain way, like that changes pressure and temperature in a certain way, and then that changes flow again in a certain way. And if you have like enough energy for a cyclone to form, like, you know, you have enough water vapor evaporating and stuff like that, you get organized structures of a certain kind.
Yeah, ma'am. So you mentioned that sometimes predictions are made even for the general public by satellite data or something like that. So how well has been the collaborations with people in the administration or in the government in such cases? For example, we recently had a talk where people in India-based neutrino observatory, they were facing some problems with their collaboration with people in the government. And similarly, for example, we had tsunamis and other climate problems. When they happen, I expect you would have to collaborate with people in the government also. So how does that happen? Yeah.
So with some organizations, we've had amazing luck. Like we've met amazing scientists who like are after solving the problem, and they've willingly come and join hands with us. We have nice ongoing collaboration with IITM Pune. We have a very nice understanding with ISRO, who are happy to give us satellite data of the kind we want. They're happy to spend their time and energy to give us what we want. So in most of these interactions, it's been a very nice experience working with them. But I've had difficulty coming across data of other types. For example, I spent quite some time trying to look for groundwater data and river network data. And I just went into a do loop. I don't even know whether it was, you know, some government. I don't even know whether I was actually attacking the right, going in the right direction to get this data. But I found on the internet some forms. If I fill out, I can get some data. And I never succeeded in this. They kept replying and it kept on going into a do loop. So sometimes it's difficult to get data. But most often, like when you're working with a known organization like ISRO or IITM, you'll find like quite a lot of enthusiasm on both sides, because we have complementary expertise and we can use that in a nice way.
Vatsal was talking about government. I think I read it somewhere that Professor Rodham Narasimha and his group had some predictions about the Kedarnath tragedy. I don't know if you were involved in that work, but he said that the government did not do anything about it. So
I don't know this story. Like maybe if you could tell me about it, I'll find out. I don't know this story at all.
Oh.
So is it like there were some predictions made by people and the government didn't listen to those predictions?
Yeah.
Something like that?
Yeah. Well, the 2012 Kedarnath tragedy. I read it in one of his interviews. So.
So you're talking about the inverse problem. You're talking about, you know, I already have a science finding and I want to change policy.
Yeah.
Whereas I was talking about the forward problem, like I want to get a science result for which I need the government's help. So I don't know. Maybe it's a lot harder to convert a science finding into policy. Although this time we are seeing like quite a lot of discussion between scientists and policymakers on the COVID. Okay. Are we done?
I think we can end. Are there any more questions, people? What do you say, John?
So one thing I'd like you to do is to give me like critical feedback about this talk. Even if you want to say it verbally right now, that's brilliant. If you're happy to email me, that's brilliant. But give me critical feedback so that, you know, the next time I prepare it for undergraduates, I'll know like what I should do. Because normally I speak to undergraduates, but most of the time I'm speaking to engineering undergraduates who've already done like a course or two in fluid mech.
It was nice. We were like going through all the basic things like Lagrangian derivative and Euler derivative. Like most people here, first years, I think most of the people who are participating are first years.
Okay.
And they might not have come across all these things, and you are explaining them in simple terms. That was good.
And you have been very patient with answering all these questions also.
No, no, it's a joy to answer. You guys ask good questions.
So one thing that I personally felt a bit rough was that you started with the Stokes equation of a spherical particle without any internal flows falling in a fluid, and then you went to the Navier-Stokes equation where you're essentially talking about just the fluid, I mean no particles, just the fluid.
Right, right.
And you call it you were considering fluid, but I mean. What is it called? Fluid basket or fluid
blob? You can say.
Yeah. Hmm. Right. And then from there again, when you went to the unsteady
right
Stokes equation, and then to the other equation, the Maxey-Rayleigh equation, you again invoked particles.
Correct. Correct.
So that was a little
confusing.
Difficult to visualize.
Yeah. So I can make that a bit clearer.
But I agree with Samit. But I feel that because of that, I was able to, you know, jump back and forth and actually make sure that I understand everything also. So for me, it was, yeah.
Yeah, like sometimes, you know, when you're listening to a talk, you miss like one word or half a sentence and then it becomes impossible. That shouldn't be the case. Like the important thing should be told clearly.
Yeah. Great. I think it was very nice. This was a very nice interaction. Was very nice. And,
yeah. Okay, so shall we leave the meeting?
Okay. Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Advanced Happy Women's Day.
Bye.
Yes. Happy Women's Day.
Thank you. And Happy Women's Day to all of you also.